Hey guys, number one Marmaduke fan here. All right, so it's one of these East versus West. There's not really an overarching theme, but this is just what I'm reading this week. And I think it's a tie this week. Usually I pick like one thing I read, either like the Weeb thing or the Western thing, and that was the winner. This is a good tie. So your boy Zach already reviewed this one. This is True Believers, Captain Marvel Betrayed. It's a reprint of Avengers Annual number 10. So since your boy Zach already reviewed it, I'll be brief. So one of the cool things is the cover and how the cover is basically just a series of panels, each with a promise that actually happens in the book. The penciler is Michael Golden. The inker is Armando Gill. This is one that's going into my keep for future like comic and drawing reference collection because it's such a great example of the Marvel, you know, over the top action style. It's chock full of great action sequences and, you know, everything that the cover promises you happens in the book. But it also has maybe like a couple wonky faces. Let me see if I can find that one. Yeah, like this one of Kitty Pryde. I'm just thinking, oh man, my boy, Michael Golden, are you sure about that? Are you sure you want to draw it that way? But then, as you just keep reading it, like the overall effect is so exciting and so dynamic. I do think the perfect illustration of it is the golden age of illustrators who, you know, would do like Robin Hood books and Don Quixote and Ivanhoe. I think that after the golden age of illustration ended, Marvel started to capture that kind of energy in their comic books for this era. I just had all kinds of flashbacks to reading the black and white Marvel Essential books when I was a little kid. And a lot of stuff went over my head. Like, I think I was just saying, oh boy, cool superheroes fighting. And I'd kind of get a feel that there was a lot of emotional fighting going on, but I wouldn't really quite understand it. This is just a great issue in general. Like, all of the appearances that people make, they kind of feel natural. They get you excited to go check out what was going on in X-Men. It kind of reminds you that, you know, oh, male gaze, by the way. It kind of reminds you that a lot of these characters have done pretty bad stuff, like Rogue, for example. So there's a lot of, you know, like emotional weight to that, trying to find redemption, trying to make up for your mistakes in the past. There's like a great big giant would be a trillion dollar special effects sequence. Another kind of like weird big bug eye. Look, it's not just Weebs. Weebs aren't the only artists who sometimes have weird big bug eyes. It's a general thing. And your boy Zach already mentioned that this is the issue where we kind of see Carol Danvers having all of this like emotional grief for like this really crazy, hard to explain plot with like a god who impregnated her, and she felt like the Avengers didn't help her at all, and they weren't able to help her in that situation. But so the point, the narrative impact of this is you get this great, you know, giant battle sequence between the Brotherhood of Evil Mutants and the Avengers, and Spider-Woman as a guest star, and Captain America, the great hero, being defeated, right? It's a fantastic fight. And then it ends with the Avengers kind of learning that they screwed up and they didn't do they weren't as helpful to their friend as they needed to be. They need to be better heroes, right? So it's a great little punch at the gut at the end. Chris Claremont, he gets roasted a lot for being pretty verbose. And this is a pretty verbose issue, but so much stuff happens in it. It's absolutely packed with entertainment. So I won't say much more because I just love this era. So people have asked me, like, how do I get into comics? And what I'm trying to show is, like, I'm going to the library, I'm buying $1 books. If you can get those used Marvel Essential black and white books, it's actually probably one of the worst ways to read Marvel comics because they're black and white and color is so important to Marvel comics. But you can get a good crash course on like the best years of X. Oh, I had a really weird reason for reading them when I was a kid. Someone told me there was an ice cream man in X-Men, and I was really interested to see this ice cream man. So I just started reading my way through all of these old Avengers and X-Men Essentials books trying to find Ice Cream Man. And I never did, but I ended up reading all the way through like this great kind of golden age run. That's not the right term for it, but basically, people use the word golden age comics in kind of a weird way. They use that to refer to like the 40s, the 30s and 40s. I think the golden age of Marvel comics came in sort of the 70s and the 80s was when they really started like ascending it to a brand new art form. But anyway, moving on to our next thing, Tite Kubo's Bleach. My thoughts on it. Okay, everybody has told me Bleach is really good, and then some people have said they don't like it when it gets to the Soul Society, and I'm just getting into the Soul Society. And one thing I've noticed is the tone has shifted from kind of these really creepy, really interesting takes on life and death, and now it's becoming a generic adventure. Male gaze problematic, by the way, and I'm still digging it. Like, I like the idea of, like, the team of teenagers breaking into the Soul Society to save their girlfriend Rukia and, like, fighting all the guys. That's plenty of fun. What I really liked in the early chapters in Bleach was kind of the thought about death meaning something, death impacting people, preparing yourself for death. And there was this very natural transition where Ichigo was kind of like getting put through the ringer, being told he's not all that. You got to train super hard and get super strong so you can save your friend. And now pretty much this entire volume is them breaking into the Soul Society to save their friend. So number one, Chad demonstrates the correct way to heroically save someone by majestically throwing them over your shoulder and carrying them out of danger. Does Uryu ever do anything useful, by the way? He had a cool introduction, but he doesn't seem to be adding that much to the team so far. But one of the things I like about Shonen Jump books is how much they are very viscerally, like, little kids would love these, even if there's mature themes in the book that aren't appropriate for little kids. Like, when I was an art tutor, something I'd notice about little boys' stories is there'd be lots of dinosaurs and trucks and monsters and superheroes, and then there would be combinations of all these things and tornado attacks. Like, little boys' stories are just endless series of fantastic fights and specialist effect sequences, and who needs a plot? Right? So something I like about Tite Kubo is those early volumes had that really kind of deep emotional, you know, dealing with death aspect to them. And getting into this is just like lots of, you know, cool fights. Okay, now you gotta fight the giant. Okay, we beat the giant, but now we gotta beat the creepy guy with like the weird cutting power. And there's even like this thing where, like, when you see the giant, he's super big and super strong, which is how you know he's super strong. And then the creepy guy shows up and he cuts the giant. And so, wow, if he cuts the giant, then he must be super duper strong. And there's a neat aspect to his visual design. Visual look is everything in comics. So the creepy guy has like the slinky hair and this long pointed jaw and this creepy smile, and he closes his eyes and he's got a dinky little short sword, which means when he cuts the giant, it looks cool because he's the opposite of what you'd expect. You'd expect the guy who's bigger and stronger than the giant to be really big and really strong, but the creepy skinny guy with the teeny tiny sword, well, he beat the giant, so wow, what's his ability? And the drawing style changes. So I've mentioned that Tite Kubo loves using solid black and solid white a lot, but then when he establishes this guy as a credible threat, he starts putting like sketchy lines all over him and all over his face to kind of make him look shady and a little fearsome. And look, like all the brush strokes down there terminating into nothingness. Like, because he feels visually different from the normal kind of solid black and white style of the rest of the book, something about, because it feels visually different and because the sketchy lines kind of make you feel a little unsettled, it fits perfectly with his character. So that was really dope. I love the title pages. I'll talk about those more later. So another strength Tite Kubo has is he doesn't fall into same face syndrome. Chad has a very masculine, you know, jutting jaw. Like this little incidental character, he's supposed to be like a Japanese kid who died in 1950. And he gives him like an old school haircut. He gives him maybe a little bit more of a, you know, chubby jaw, so he doesn't just look like a normal anime kid. And he makes him look like, yeah, that's kind of like what a, you know, actor in a good old black and white Japanese movie would look like. He changes it up to help you keep everyone visually distinct. Why'd I mark this? Okay, he also, not Ichigo, that's the character. Tite Kubo also changes up his style very flexibly and does a lot of interesting things. So on this, like there's a little comedic bit where Ichigo's teaching Orihime a little bit and she gets like this Cartoon Network style hand. I've seen hands exactly like that in Samurai Jack, and then she'll get like this Silly Billy, you know, cartoon hand as she's getting freaked out. So he's using a Silly Billy cartoon style to add to the comedic effect of a, you know, silly scene. But it's also showing how he, like, hops around. He doesn't just draw in one derivative manga style. He's always changing things up. Later... Okay, this guy... This cat... Did I miss something? Okay, Yoriuchi. Tite Kubo had a comment that he saw a black cat hanging out next to his bicycle, and he wanted to put that in the comic. And it feels like Yoriuchi just suddenly showed up and started talking to them like a sensei without an origin story. And I kind of love it. Part of me is wondering, did I miss something? Did I miss this guy's origin story? But he just shows, this little black cat shows up and just starts giving Ichigo all of this advice on how to become a tough guy Soul Reaper, kind of out of the blue. And I love that he's just drawn like a normal black cat. He's not drawn like a cutesy bootsy stuffed animal Sailor Moon cat. So it gives him this really weird edge and creepiness to him. And I kind of love the idea that Tite Kubo basically just got the inspiration from seeing a black cat hanging out next to his bike. This page I marked. All right, so this is a like 1970s op art, kind of like drug inspired, you know, Beatles poster title page, right? So you know, there's some things going on unrealistically where the black shape is in front of her but then pushing behind her, and then there's like the big over the top letters and, you know, funny bubble lettering. And basically what he's doing is in every one of these title pages, he's trying something. So he tried like let's try a 1970s rock band art poster for this one. And later he'll try like calligraphy marks with, you know, Chinese brush. And it makes them all feel fresh and unique. It's one of the most interesting aspects about this is all the different stuff he does. Is that a JoJo reference? And towards the end, he does this cool thing where he took a break from this for a while, but now he's doing these really cool character profiles where he shows you a loose pencil sketch, and you can see it in his pencil sketch. He has a sketchy style in his pencil sketch when he inks and brings in some of those like scary lines. He has a sketchy style in his inking style. So I just love seeing that kind of relation of one thing to another. And he thinks so much about the little details of his characters, like their theme song. That's great. All right, Natsume Ono. I'm going to keep reviewing Natsume Ono stories because I'm kind of in love with her. I'd read her years ago and I remembered being really impressed. And I'm just falling in love with her again because she's so weird. And all of her stories are about, so far, all of them are about fatherhood in some way. So something I've said about Natsume Ono is she does kind of slow-paced slice-of-life stories, but she packs a lot of whomph into that. So it's not just, oh no, I tripped and I dropped the cake, and now I feel sad that I dropped the cake. Like, she's talking about, like, really meaningful stuff, like not having a good relationship with your father and then trying to reconnect with your father. That's almost been every story so far. So the first one was, like, a kid who his mother and father divorced, and he tried to kind of like reconnect with his father as an adult, and he finally was able to. Spoiler warning, by the way, since these are kind of like really simple, really poetic slice of life stories, it's kind of like a good short story. It kind of has a point to it, and then you get to the end and you say, oh, that's the point. And you kind of like, it's almost like you take a deep breath and you say, ah, I get it, right? So that means that there's not like a lot of meat to dig into it. Like, the point of the story is the point. So I'm basically going to spoil the main point of the story because I really appreciate it. So spoiler warning, Chronicle Cornice 2, Memories of the Lake. This is another like father-son kind of story where the early pages are all about setting up the boy character. And the impression we have is he's kind of like a little adult. He is very independent. He doesn't like depending on adults to do anything for him. And a lot of this comes off in like his body language, how he talks to strangers, how he fends for himself. And lots of this is silent buildup. And the point of the silent buildup is for you to kind of like look at the person, kind of wonder what their deal is. You see the wonky face, but you really understand the expression. I'll talk more about her wonky expressions later. And this guy shows up, kind of like this weird old stranger shows up who looks a little bit like the kid and looks a little bit like the kid's father. And he just sort of like, the kid invites this stranger into his home. Even the stranger's kind of like surprised, won't your dad get mad? And what we learn is that the son and the father basically have no relationship at all. The father's always working. The son barely looks at him as a father. The son basically lives with his aunt after the mother is dead. And the stranger observes that the boy actually deeply wants to have a relationship with his father. It appears to me that he wants to be reprimanded by you for being wasteful, for listening, for letting strangers into the house. So this is a really deep thing. Like, a boy who is sort of like acting older than he is. He doesn't act like a child at all because he's trying to cope with not having a mother and not really having a father in his life. And at the same time, wanting any kind of relationship with his father, even if it's like it's like a child misbehaving because they want their dad to yell at them, because even that's better than having their dad ignore them all the time. That's really deep stuff. Ouch, that hurts. And then there's like a time travel aspect to it. But the time travel aspect isn't like Back to the Future, kind of like, oh, crazy time travel stuff. All the time travel is in this story is basically, what if you as a son could go back and meet your father and your grandfather when they were young? And could you do something to kind of like help them work through that and work it out? Do I want to spoil it? I guess I got to spoil it to talk about it. So what I love about Natsumi Ono is, when you get to the end of the story, it's like a poetic moment where you understand, oh, okay, and you kind of could see the relation to that to your own life. So the time traveler from the future, he was actually he is his grandson, and his father is the little kid. He's come back in time to meet his father and grandfather because he promised his father that he would. He asked his father when he was dying, what's the one thing you wish? And his father said, I wish I could have gone fishing with my father just once. So he comes back in time and he kind of like persuades his grandfather to take the kid fishing once. But then at the end, he reveals the law is you can't have any memory of me. So I'm going to erase all of your memories of these past few days, including the fishing trip. So even though you won't remember it, at least I'll have satisfied my father's wish of getting to fish with his father one time, even if he forgets it. And then as his father is dying, his father remembers getting to fish. That hits you right there, right? Anyway, yeah, that kind of like shook me up a little bit. Now number three, Diorama. This is actually my favorite one so far, because once again, it's like a fatherhood story. It's about a son-in-law trying to connect with his father-in-law. The son-in-law is German, the father-in-law is Japanese, and very traditionally Japanese. You can tell that he is not stoked that his daughter married an American German guy. What I want to talk about. All right. So Natsune Ono is weird. I don't think she does structure drawings at all. I think she just starts drawing like an eye, and then she figures out everything. And if she doesn't know where to put the other eye, then she just won't draw it. But because she gets expression and she gets characters, she gives warmth to the expression you need. So like the father-in-law is worried because he doesn't have any connection at all to his son-in-law. He misses his daughter and wants to see his daughter more. Maybe he feels like the son-in-law has taken his daughter away from him, and he has no clue what to do. There's this beautiful thing where when the son-in-law shows up, he's this massive, tall German kid. So he's literally too tall to fit in the house, and symbolically, he doesn't fit in this culture and in this world. The visual aspect of the character relates to his problem. He doesn't fit in. And even their daughter, she has a Japanese name, but she clearly takes after her father. So the Japanese father-in-law, it's clear that he and the German son just don't get along. They don't get each other at all. But the German son, the German son-in-law deeply respects his father-in-law because he likes manly men. He likes men who, you know, care about their country and care about their culture and don't sacrifice their principles. So they actually have a lot in common, except for this cultural barrier separating them. And the daughter and the son-in-law deeply want the father-in-law to come to America to visit them, and he just doesn't want to go because he just likes Japan. He doesn't want to leave Japan. He's kind of like a cranky old guy, but he has this really beautiful hobby of making these dioramas, and it's a deeply important thing to him, a deeply personal thing to him, and he doesn't want anyone messing with his dioramas. Now, I want to find the page I marked with like the really weird faces. There's some panel that really illustrates the point nicely, and I can't find it. But basically, even when like, okay, this I wanted to show this actually. So because I think Natsumi Ono doesn't do structure drawings, I think she just starts drawing. What that means is her characters are just lines on a page. They don't have a skeleton. They don't have like muscle mass, but they have a lot of warmth in the way that it's like how you could look at an electrical socket and see a face in it, because people really want to identify with human faces and even like abstract human faces. He gets this warmth where he just shows the hairline and she doesn't even draw like the top of the skull, and yet you completely understand the person. You kind of feel like the fact that it's so narrow, you feel like there's this emotional tension to it that he can't resolve, and the sad expression. It's just great. It's the perfect, rough, kind of weird, unschooled art style. I can't find the panel I was looking for. But basically, because she doesn't do this, she's always consistently, like, changing up her faces and changing up, like, none of them ever feel super realistic, yet you always understand what's going on in the characters' heads. And there's this beautiful moment at the end. This is the important part. I'm spoiling everything. The boy's problem at first was he was too tall to fit in the house. Now, because he's so tall and he's so big and strong, he can carry his father-in-law on his shoulders and sort of show him a different perspective of his house that he's always wanted to see. He's always wanted to see his house kind of from the perspective that he has when he's working on his dioramas, and so the son's weakness, that he's too tall, he doesn't really fit in, becomes a strength. Because he's tall, he's able to relate to his father-in-law in this weird way. The thing that was keeping them apart, the cultural differences, are now being something that they're getting past, and they're forming a relationship. It's just, yet he's still like a crushy, grouchy old Japanese guy at the end, because he doesn't compromise who he is. It's a great, I love her so much. I love that she's really concerned about the role of fatherhood and relating to your father. I don't think that's every story, but it's the first three so far, and I love Natsumi Ono. You gotta trust me on this. She's weird. No one draws like her. It's sometimes awkward, but there is just so much great emotion and so much great use of quiet, simple moments to build up to a really poignant point at the end. All right, I can't pick a winner today. Three books, I'm happy with all three. 21 minutes, let's wrap it up here. I'm a number one Marmaduke fan. I love you guys. Catch you later.